host of OLA Sierra Leone. I'm going to really briefly introduce our speaker and friend, George Dombo, and I'll tell him a little bit about who's here in the audience as well. We have mostly both first and second year IPCR students, including the students that are going to be traveling with us to Sierra Leone this spring, and some other undergraduate students who are heading to Sierra Leone with us as well. If you're going to Sierra Leone, the Sierra Leone class, raise your hands just so you know who each other are. This is like my little community building, since you don't all know each other. And we'll all meet each other soon, and it'll be fun. It's going to be a really great trip. So George Dombo is a friend and contact in Sierra Leone. He works for the Ministry of Youth Affairs, which is our hosting ministry when we're there. They've been very good to us in the past and been really gracious about helping us connect with speakers and doing a generally wonderful job of hosting us when we're there. George's own background started working in various nonprofit organizations doing community developing, and this is his first foray into government work, which he seems to be enjoying a great deal and hopes to do more of. And most recently, he's been helping the Ministry of Youth Affairs figure out how to develop programs to deal with some of the various crises that have spun off of the Ebola crisis, which are the kinds of things he's going to be talking about now. I think those of you who are going on this trip with me know, I've told you that the way I run these global field study courses is the course is not driven by what I know, the course is driven by a big question that I have or something that I want to learn about. And what I'm really curious about vis-a-vis Sierra Leone post-Ebola is how have things changed, how has Ebola changed things for the worst and maybe a little bit for the better, what's changing on the ground, how has life radically been changed after this terrible, terrible outbreak. And there's a lot of things that you might think of and a lot of things that you might not think of. Over lunch, George was telling us a little bit about some of those things. So I'm really eager to hear his talk, to hear about all of those different things that we'll learn about here and during our course and during our time in Sierra Leone in May and June. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to George.
Thank you so much, Dr. Arabia. I didn't know you know so much about me. I'm going to thank you so much. Dr. Amy Cox, Director of the IPRC Program. Dr. Jennifer Reagan, the Associate Professor of the Department of History and Medical Studies. Student Coordinators of the Department of Public Health. I want to mention the guys here because this team actually helped us in terms of sending some PPEs for us back home when we had the crisis. The entire faculty staff and students of this great university. And of course, your students of the International Peace and Conflict Resolution. I bring you greetings from Sierra Leone, the people and government of my country, more specifically from the Minister of Youth Affairs, the Honorable Amami A. Kamara. And of course, my humble self and my family. It's a pleasure being at Acadia University this afternoon to talk to you, Sierra Leone post-Ebola recovery plan, the role of the youth in eradicating the virus itself, and what we have as a youth agenda in the recovery process. I'll be speaking to you on this title. And at the end of my presentation, of course, I'll encourage questions, comments, feedbacks, so as to know that we are well abreast with the little presentation I'm going to give here this afternoon. So once more, a privilege to be in your midst this afternoon and to visit this great university. I also want to bring you greetings from Fodi Badabo. He also helped in making sure that I'm here this afternoon. Tammy is not here, my regards to her, and all those who facilitated my presence here this afternoon. I'll now go straight to what I'm going to present to you this afternoon. There will be a little bit of the introduction. I'll give you an objective of the recovery plan itself in Sierra Leone. How the country was before the Ebola crisis. We'll look at some of the development impacts. In terms of the recovery itself, what are the priorities in terms of immediate responses and progresses that have made so far? I'll also talk a little bit about the role played by the youth themselves, the young people of our country, in making sure that the Ebola is being eradicated, that some of the lessons learned. What we have in the recovery process or the plan set for the young people of Serengeti. Then I will conclude. I just want to give you a small background about the youth. In our country, we're talking about a young person. It's those between the age brackets of 15 to 35 years of age, which I'm sure for the UN system, it's very different from that sort of for 15 to 24. In other countries, it moves beyond that. But for Sierra Leone, it's those between the age brackets of 15 to 35 are regarded as young people, both male and female. Now, the Ebola itself, I think I will ask that if you, I'll give you the soft copy of this, I'll leave it. I'll also give you the video clips. And I'll give you my contact so that if you have more questions to ask, which will not allow because of time, then I will be privileged about you to give your feedback on those comments. The Ebola actually struck on the 24th of May, 2014. And what is interesting about this date for the month itself was a period when your colleagues that are phased out of the university were there. They actually were there in May that same year. And it started in a very, very small village in the eastern part of Sierra Leone, referred to as Kailam District. And it started moving and it ravaged the entire 149 chiefdoms that we have in our country. And a total of 8,704 were infected during the outbreak. And out of that number, we lost 3,589 of our brothers, our sisters, our uncles, aunts, relatives, loved ones, including 221 medical doctors. The reason why I'm in the United States is to lay to rest one of those doctors that died at the Nebraska Hospital, Dr. Martin Salia. Was laid to rest this past Saturday in Maryland. And this moment, I'll just crave your indulgence that I pause a little bit. Whilst I want to pay special tribute to the head workers and all those Ebola response workers who made the ultimate sacrifice, losing their own lives as they try to save the lives of others. Shall we have a minute's silence for their souls? May their souls rest in perfect peace. Now, we have about 35,000 of Sierra Leoneans that serve in various capacities in the fight against Ebola. This number is those that we are recognized. We have others that volunteer that could number what I have just said. And of course, the international community and development partners, the role they play in the fight against Ebola, very extraordinary. And we want to doff our hats for that. And I want to mention here that support from Acadia was very timely and immense. I remember last year, we were able to get some quantum of cartons of PPEs that we are from this university to help the fight against Ebola. And I want to register our appreciation and thanks to all those who contributed immensely in making sure that that PPE will be used to better the lives and to fight the Ebola itself. It was very timely, and it went through one of the community-based organizations, Heal Initiative, and I want to thank all of those guys that were involved in mobilizing the resources that brought about the provisions of those PPEs. One good thing I was talking to Dr. Jennifer just now, On Saturday the 7th, my country was declared Ebola free. You will imagine how the faces were. Before the end of the presentation, I will give you a video clip of how joyous we were at that time. Candlelight processions and that kind of thing. Because having stayed indoors for more than a year, not moving out, not doing the things that we used to do, it's but for the grace of God that the 7th of November we had the World Health Organization declare Israel Ebola free. And from that date up to now, we are still moving on. It's about 66 days now, and we are climbing up to the 90 days. Because research has told us that the virus in the survival of a male semen can survive up to 3 months. So we want to see exactly what will happen in the next 90 days. And we are moving on. And we pray that by the special grace of God, we'll not have any case, we'll continue to move on to the zero, you know, figure. I remember when we are in school, nobody wants to get a zero figure, a zero mark. But whilst we are praying, we are also asking God that let us have zero, zero, zero. That is not a mark any students would love to have. But in the Ebola crisis, we would love to have a zero mark. At the moment, we have our 4,051 survivors, and we consider them to be our heroes. Now, on the objective is restoring Sierra Leone on the path to prosperity. Before Ebola struck, we have had an agenda referred to as the Agenda for Prosperity, A4P, 2013 and 2018. A five lifespan. But that was disrupted as a result of the Ebola. So now that we are on the recovery process itself, we want to ensure that we restore all those developmental programs that we are moving forward that will make Sierra Leone once more a loving on the earth hills of West Africa. How was Sierra Leone before the Ebola crisis? I'm sure most of you are aware that in 1991, there was a rebel incursion in our country that spanned up to 11 years that ended in 2002. As a result of that, Sierra Leone was acclaimed by the United Nations as an example in terms of post-conflict recovery. And therefore, we had missions. We had a military men, police guys that currently are even on missions in other conflict African countries. That shows that indeed our country was able to recover from the rebel war, and the mission ended in March 2014. Currently now we are now moving on. And since the end of the rebel war, we have had four democratically elected in a government for free and fair elections. One was held in 1996, we had one in 2002, we had one in 2007, and the last one was this 2012. And hopefully in 2017-18, we'll move again to another general elections and that of the presidential elections. We have also had, look at council elections. We have one in 2014, 2004. We also have one in 2008, and we had one in 2012. So those are like the community parliaments, local councils, that do the government work in their respective localities. Our economy was growing as the one of the fastest growing economies in the world. If you look at the statistics, our gross domestic product in 2012 talks about 6%. In 2011, 6%, 2012 was 15.2%, and 2013 was 20.1%. You can see the trend in terms of making progress. The inflation itself dropped from double digits in 2012 to 6.4% in 2013. Even the dollar, you know, was coming down, and therefore development was moving on. The poverty headcount decreased from 70% in 2003 to 52% in 2013. You see, imagine in terms of progress being made. We are able to install energy capacity that increased from less than 5 megawatts in 2007 to more than 100 megawatts. Now, guys, that we're going to fix, and you'll see that light will be all over the place. We have 11 major agribusinesses with a collective investment about $1.6 billion US dollars that provided 17,000 jobs. Can you imagine? That was before the Ebola crisis itself. So many, after the rebel war, we are moving steadily in terms of moving Sierra Leone back on the map, back on track. More than 1,000 kilometer roads paved. You know, before this time, we just have like 2 lanes in every part of Sierra Leone. But now we can go to like 4 lanes, two over here, in, two coming in, coming out. So like development was progressing. We are moving on with infrastructure, making sure that the lives are better in our country. But for Ebola, I will tell you the impact as we move on. If I'm moving fast, I hope you slow me down. If not, I think we'll move on. We continue with the resilience in terms of before the crisis itself. We have a free health care introduced for pregnant women, for lactating mothers and under fives. What was the result of that? That delivery and health facilities doubled from 25% to 56%. Before this time, most of our women would go to those quack doctors, you know, or nurses, or bad attendants to deliver. And in the process, they would just die because they do not have the medical facilities. But as a result of the introduction of free healthcare that was done in 2010 April, a whole lot of lives have been saved as a result of, you know, that free healthcare that was introduced. Also, use of treated bed nets against malaria moved from 26% to 49% for under fives. And of course, a lot of pregnant women from 27% to 23%. I remember I was doing some history about Sierra Leone, and I was told in some of the books the reason why Sierra Leone is not like South Africa, that the mosquitoes drove away the white guys, the colonial masters. They could not stay long in our country because of the mosquitoes. And of course, mosquitoes, from all indications, had to spread malaria disease. So what does that happen? Because of that, we have a lot of treated mosquito nets, bed nets, as they are called, and that has also reduced malaria, as you can see from the fever in terms of percentages. Of course, the aspect of drop in infants and under five's mortality. You'll see 107 per 1,000 births in 2010. As a result, now, to 92 to 1,000 births in 2015. You'll see the drastic reduction, all as a result of the free healthcare introduced by His Excellency the President, Dr. Agnes Bike-Grover. Another significant aspect of the aspect of accountability. Most times, African governments are called to account. There is this aspect of the World Bank Index as a way of looking at accountability in terms of governance for African countries. And again, Sierra Leone, of course, we had like plus 14.9 score when the report was read in 2013. Sierra Leone, of course, was ranked among the 10 green business reformers by the World Bank in 2011. As a result of the iron ore that we have and all those other natural resources that are in that country. we are so blessed and endowed with natural resources. Then, of course, the 50-50 gender parity in schools achieved. Before this time, the enrollment of boys in schools more than that of girls. But because of looking at, we are reducing the gender lens, we are now realize that it's better for us to have more girls in school also than boys. So we are now moving on, and the enrollment of the girls in school is much more better, you know, before the crisis itself. And that has helped us greatly. And there is this old adage that when you educate a man, it's just one person you are educating. But if you educate a woman, it's like you educate a nation. So my countryside don't believe in that adage. And therefore, we believe it is what important that we encourage the girl enrollment also in our schools and tertiary institutions. Now, what I've just said, you look at the development impact now. Now, if you look at down here, over here, from here you'll see it, the chain moving. And when it comes down here, you see that about 15.2%, 2012, 20 is about 20. But oh my God, after Ebola, low iron oil prices, it dropped down as it always moves down to minus 23.5%. That was really devastating for our country. Really, really devastating. Really, really devastating. It dropped down to minus 23%. That was, we had a steady growth between 2000 to 2011, an average annual growth of 5.3%. It was moving. Large-scale iron ore mining restarted in our country. But oh my God, when Ebola came, it was just too heavy for us. So while we had the economic shocks, the Ebola outbreak, the falling oil prices, the GDP is projected to contract about minus 23.5%, including the iron ore itself, and 1.0% with non-iron ore. The revenue loss as a result of the Ebola estimated about 350 billion euros, an equivalent to $70 million as an economic loss. You can imagine that. The 30% decline in our agricultural outputs, 60% drop in manufacturing outputs, 50% job loss in the private sector. All restaurants, entertainment centers, we are closed. Even those hotels could not run as a result of the Ebola. So you can imagine the economic loss so that you're experienced during this period. 5 new investment ventures were suspended. You know, the investors, we are running to Sierra Leone as if the diamonds, the golds, everything was just in that country. The iron was just moving, the oil was even prospected, and they found that we had oil in that country. In different parts, gold, we are from different areas, the rutile is there, we have a bauxite, we have a chromite. These are all natural resources we have in that country. So investors, we are moving from all over the world down to Sierra Leone. But as a result of Ebola, what happened, we are able to suspend 5 of those investors not to move in. And of course, the cross-border trade disrupted, and that's what brought about the CPI, that's the Consumer Price Index, was greatly affected. Now, certainly, most times our trading activities between the 3 Maritime Union countries, that is Sierra Leone, Guinea, and Liberia, and those who are the 3 countries were affected by Ebola. So can you imagine, no cross-border trade, everybody stay in your own country, you don't move, and all those doing businesses, that was just the end of it. And it was really, really, really devastating, difficult to think about. So that was how Sierra Leone was before the crisis. And as a result of the crisis, those were the shocks that we had,
in terms of our economic loss. As I said, certainly nice Ebola free since November 7th. What have we started to do? There is the 6 to 9 months recovery plan. And we are looking at four thematic areas. One is health. What was quickly done? 40 hospitals and 1,300 peripheral health units. These are like small health posts in chiefdoms or in communities, you know, that can cater for, like, say, 300 to 500 individuals within that community. So 1,300 of them, including 40 hospitals, have been reopened. 65% of these PHUs have upgraded infection prevention and control. There's already this idea that prevention is better than cure. So now we have upgraded that aspect that we now prevent instead of being cured. And the aspect of also restoring essential health services like the HIV and AIDS patients resume. Now, when Ebola struck, we forgot about the HIV and AIDS issue altogether. That was just faculty. So what was happening behind the scene was a different story. But when we've now started treating the patients, TB, that's tuberculosis, malaria treatment also recommends in all the PHUs. One of the problems was sick people for maybe malaria or high fever, those who are not Ebola, were afraid to access the hospitals. They were not going to these hospitals for fear that when they get to these hospitals, they will say they are Ebola because the symptoms of malaria is the same with Ebola. I remember there was a time and I felt a little bit, you know, nostalgia. I was feeling sick. I said, well, come on, we have to go to the hospital. I said to myself, no. So I went to this pharmacy, you know, and I bought a few tabs, treated myself home, without even acknowledging myself to know what was actually wrong. So a lot of people also died. Not of Ebola, but other illnesses, because they fail to go to medical centers. So, the free healthcare initiative now is being expanded and to the survivors of the disease itself and the victims of gender-based violence and pregnant teenage. Now, it's sad to really report that we had like about 3,000 pregnant girls as a result of this Ebola, the highest to be registered in the health sector of our country. And it's unmanageable that we had to experience that kind of thing. So programs are now underway by the government and the government partners to ensure that we find a way of reducing teenage pregnancy. The other thematic area is out of education, and 8,000 schools and tertiary institutions reopened safely with wash facilities, facilities. And also to all the schools, the prevention protocols in terms of washing your hands, making sure that you don't touch, the use of thermometer to check the temperature. The temperatures are all in place in those schools because we do not want an outbreak. An outbreak in one school will definitely create a lot of alarm and problem for the entire people of that school. So there's 95% adherence to that prevention protocols. Government, being what it is, with fees. That's tuition fees for all students in government-supported schools. They're also providing feeding programs for the primary schools. There is a special need programs for the physically challenged. And as I speak now, there's a commission responsible for disability
And government is working through us to make sure that those special needs are attended to, because disability is not your ability, and therefore they need to be cared for. And of course, the aspect of the in terms of class may reduce, not having so many people in one class was also part of that process. Now, the aspect of social protection, support given to vulnerable groups like survivors. So like the 12,000 Interpol and AVD survivors receiving cash transfers. This is being done by the National Action for Social, that's an AXA. There's also the 10,000 orphans and 2,000 AVD survivors supported with packages so as to start their livelihood. We also have the private sector development. About 100,000 farmers have been supported with seeds and fertilizers for this year plant season. We have now an improved market access for farmers. Two transforming 50 ABCs. ABCs is agricultural business centers. We want to see how we can transform those centers into small companies. And that process is now moving on. The aspect of also refurbishing 20 rice and cassava processors. Remember, we went to one village, in Polokwa district, where you have that cassava grating machine. So government has also refurbished about 20 of those, and more to be refurbished, so that we encourage, you know, our farmers into something added value in terms of whatever they produce. And we also have, as I said, rehabilitated about 1,800 kilometers of feeder roads. We also want to recapitalize the financial institutions and to ensure access, you know, to more resources by the farmers and other petty traders. Area at hardest hit. I believe that if they have access to resources, financial resources, they will come back to their normal life and they will be able to move on with their livelihoods. So these are like the four priority areas that government is moving on. There's also this aspect of water, energy. There's also the aspect of us maintaining the zero tolerance. And therefore, it calls for resilience on our part.